Hello, investors, and welcome to our session here today. My name is Ken Rose, and this is Short Verticals. All righty, we're ready to get going here today. So interesting last few days in the market. The market has been showing some signs of weakness, with some sectors and individual stocks moving to the downside. What is the market overall telling us, though? Is it telling us that we should be bullish or bearish or neutral or somewhere in between? And how does the short vertical strategy fit into that? Well, that'll be the topic of our discussion here today. And so with that, let's go ahead and get underway. And to start off with, we just want to run through a few disclosures here, a few reminders here. Investors, do keep in mind that options do carry a high level risk and are not suitable for all investors. Schwab does not recommend the use of technical analysis as the sole means of investment research. For the sake of simplicity, the examples in this presentation do not take into consideration commissions and other transaction fees, tax consideration, or margin requirements, which are factors that may significantly affect the economic consequences of the strategies displayed. We do use a paper-money application here. This is for educational purposes only. We want to remember that successful virtual trading during one time period does not guarantee successful investing of actual funds during a later time period, as market conditions do change continuously. Also, just a reminder that rolling strategies can entail additional transaction costs, including multiple contract fees, which may impact any potential return. It's also important to remember, investors, that short options can be assigned at any time up to expiration, regardless of the in-the-money amount. In-the-money option has a higher risk of being assigned early. It's important to keep that in mind because the paper money virtual trading application will not assign a short position early, which is different from what could occur in a real trading account. We will discuss the Greeks as we're going along, and with regards to our discussion here today, always do keep in mind, investors, the past performance of any security or strategy does not guarantee future results or success. All right, so with that, let's just go ahead and jump right in. And to do that, I'm going to bring up the Thinkorswim platform right here. We can take a peek at this, and let's just jump right into our discussion here. So here we have the S&P 500. We'll take a look at the three major indices to kind of get an idea of what our sentiment would be in relationship to this market. Would we be bullish, bearish? Would we be neutral? As I indicated at the top here, we have had some sectors and individual stocks that have had some significant moves to the downside, but is that kind of robust with regards to the overall market? Well, let's start off by looking at this chart here with regards to the S&P 500. Maybe discuss some of the key things that we may be looking for in determining what our overall sentiment would be in relationship to the market. We have the chart up here. I just want to come over here and check in the chat window. Looks like we have Michael Fairborn here with us. Great to have Mike here. Very knowledgeable investor. Do feel free to send your questions over there to Mike. But again, do want to welcome Barad and George and Tom and AJ, Seattle, Michelle, Life in the Fast Lane, Thomas, Peter, Ray, and everybody else, Wayne, David, Kevin, and Christian, and everybody else. It's great to have a great group here today. So welcome to all. And let's go ahead and get underway here. So we're looking at the S&P 500 here. I'm just going to bring up a little drawing tool here so we can make some notes as we're going along here. Yeah, that's probably going to work out okay. Well, actually, let's go with a different... Let's try that guy. There we are. Okay, so just to begin, let's talk about some fundamental basics with regards to technical analysis as far as downtrends, uptrends, neutral, and that type of thing. If we're looking at the S&P 500, you can see that coming back over here in about mid-July, the S&P 500 had a big move to the downside, had a nice recovery here earlier in August, came back down and had a little bit of a bounce here, then came up here. And by the 1st of September, then we had a big move down here during the latter part of September, first part of October, a little bit of a recovery here, and then a move to the downside. One of the key characteristics we can see here, folks, is what is going on with the highs. There's a high right there. There's a high right there. There's a high right there. And there's a high right there. So what's going on here is the highs are getting lower. So that's the first thing you want to look at, is what's going on with the highs as well as what's going on with the lows. What's going on with the lows? Here's a low. Here's a low. Here's a low. Here's a low. With the exception of this low right here, the lows are getting higher as well. I do note that right here, we actually came off of a higher low, but then we came up here and we failed to make a higher high in relationship to this high. If we would have made a higher high, then we could have said at that particular time that the trend is changing, but that didn't happen. We came up here and we had sort of a false positive here, rolled and continued to move to the downside. So this little section right here, looking at the market, this would be primarily bearish. We'd be looking at short verticals from a bearish standpoint. In other words, we'd be looking at short call verticals, primarily in market conditions like this. And with regards to potential entry on those short verticals, we'd be looking at those times when we break down from a peak like that, okay? Rather than, you know, if you look at this, in a downtrending market, there are bullish moves. You know, there's a bullish move, there's a bullish move, there's a bullish move. So we want to avoid the bullish moves. We're actually looking in a downtrending market, we're looking for recovery. And then as we're rolling over at a lower high, possibly an entry there, or a recovery as we approach a theoretical resistance level, then possibly look at an entry there. So this is kind of like the bearish situation where you'd probably look to employ a short call vertical. But what's currently going on? We had this nice recovery up here, all the way up here. We sort of had this pause right here. When you do have a pause in the market, you can call that a high. Usually when you do have a pause, you have somewhat of a side trending channel. And after that, we came right up here. And once again, we've had some ups and downs here on the S&P 500. But I'd say that we've sort of fallen in this sideways channel with this as a resistance level up here. And this is a support level. And when you are in a sideways channel like this, you can go either way. You can do a short call vertical up here, or you can do a short put vertical down here, or you can do both. If you combine those together, then you'd be looking at what's called an iron condor. Now, one question would be, though, this is the S&P 500. What are the other indices telling us? Are they telling us the same type of thing? Because if you have all of the major indices, we're talking about the major indices, we're basically talking about the S&P 500, the NASDAQ 100, and the Russell 2000. If all three indices are saying the same thing, that would give us more confidence with regards to a strategy of choice. What is currently going on here, though, with regards to the other indices? I'd say here on the S&P 500, we're in this sideways channel. Should we go? If we had to make a decision between the short call vertical and the short put vertical, which way would we go? Well, one indicator that may help us out with that is the RSI. If the RSI is in this upper reversal zone and starting to break down out of that upper reversal zone, some investors may look at that as a bearish indication. We're either going to stay in this sideways channel or move to the downside because the RSI is currently in the overbought mode and possibly ripe for a move to the downside. However, you don't want to necessarily look at that for sure because we broke into this area right up in this area. Notice how the underlying security continued to move up. Now it's moving sideways, but right now we are starting to move down here a little bit with regards to RSI. So some traders may look at this from a short call vertical standpoint. Perhaps the safest thing to do would be to wait for a breakout on either side of this and possibly enter a trade on a breakout. That would be a possibility as well. Okay, so that is the S&P 500. Let's go ahead and take this guy off of here for a second and let's move over to the NASDAQ. And when we look at the NASDAQ, it's a little bit of a different scenario. The NASDAQ has had a little bit more of a pull down here. I'm going to just grab a drawing tool here. I'm going to come over here and just identify this as a support level right there. So, you know, it is somewhat similar to the S&P 500 because we bounce along this support level. We've got 1, 2, 3, 4 days over here, 1, 2 days over here. We also have this resistance level up here. If we look at the highs, it looks quite similar with regards to the NASDAQ and the S&P 500. Now, the trend that precluded this on the NASDAQ doesn't look as entrenched as what we had on the S&P 500, but still, we'd be looking at this sideways range here. And once again, if we come down here and we look at the RSI, notice the RSI came up here in the overbought area, and now it's starting to slide and move to the downside. So from that standpoint, investors may lean a little bit more towards the short call vertical up here rather than short put vertical down here. Well, last but not least of our major indices is going to be the Russell, and this doesn't look like either of those other two. So if we look at it, we've got the S&P 500 and we have the NASDAQ basically giving us the same type of a technical indication with regards to what our sentiment should be, bullish, bearish, or neutral. And then we have the Russell right here, which is decidedly more on the bullish side. If we look at the Russell, we had our sideways movement here on the Russell right here, right there in that channel right there. And we broke out of the channel. And notice when we're in the channel right here, what's going on with the RSI? It's not in the upper reversal zone until right here we broke out. It came up here and it touched the boundary there, but didn't quite get into the upper reversal zone. Now it's faded a little bit sitting right here. But With regards to the Russell, we'd be looking at this more from a bullish standpoint rather than a neutral standpoint. I would suggest that a fair number of technical investors will look at it maybe along these lines, looking at the Russell in a uptrending channel, not a visually perfect or pleasing uptrending channel, but an uptrending channel just the same. Okay. So where would we be then? Well, if we're looking at small cap stocks, we may be looking at things a little bit more bullish, particularly, you know, a large number of banks and regional banks are part of what make up the Russell 2000. So if we're looking at trading possibly a regional bank or something along those lines, we may be looking a little bit more here at the Russell rather than what we're seeing on the NASDAQ. Pull up a regional bank here example here. Let's come over here for just a second and see. Actually, we got a regional bank here that's around here in Utah. That's Zions right there. You can see that kind of moving sideways here. And we have this nice breakout, possibly a test down here and coming here to take a look at support. Okay, so let's go ahead and go with a sentiment primarily neutral at this particular point in time. And let's look at some possible candidates. And to do that, I'm going to open up our left-hand side right here. And here we have our watch list. Now, this is the same watch list that we started to put together last time. Actually, I came back in here and I completed. In other words, I went through that final step where you go in there and you check the liquidity and the strike prices and fine tune this up. So this is basically the same watch list we had last week. I just completed that last step that we engaged in and we discussed in relationship to that. Now, those of you that are saying, hey, Ken, can I get this watch list? What I would encourage you to do is to check out last week's archived video. I can go ahead and share this watch list. I can go ahead and share a link for you with this watch list. Just keep in mind, it would only be applicable to the Schwab.com thinkorswim site. It wouldn't be applicable if you are on the older site and haven't updated yet to the Schwab.com. I'll go ahead and share this link with you, okay? But do keep in mind, it won't be functional on the older one. What I'll try to do though is I'll try to pull up, because I still have access to the older site, but I'll try to pull up a link for that one and post that in the notes of the YouTube video. If you go to the bottom of the YouTube video screen, you'll see down there a short description. Part of that description will say more. When you click on more, it will open up a more detailed description. Within that detailed description, I will put a link for this watch that's going to be in there. But do keep in mind, investors, that with regards to this watch list, this is just meant to be a starting point. It is not meant to be an end point. So it's very important to watch that, how to build an option trader's watch list. And there's a link there in the YouTube notes already. You can watch that so that you can build your own, because what we have here is not likely to be what you would actually like to trade from, because we're playing the part of a specific investor that has different aspects with regards to their attitude towards risk and reward and those types of things. And yours is likely different. She may gravitate more towards different stocks. So again, click on more down the bottom of the YouTube window. Not right now, because these links will be in here about an hour and a half or 2 hours after our session. But click on more. When that opens up, look for the link that says how to build an option trader's watch list and check that one out. Okay. All right. So with that, coming back over here then, let's go ahead and look for some potential candidates here in this watch list. And as we've done in the past, I've sorted by implied volatility to bring the highest levels of implied volatility up to the top. And we've opted in here to primarily stay away from the top 10. The reason for that is there is a reason they have high levels of implied volatility, and that is that the expectation for price movement from percentage standpoint is relatively high. So we've opted to primarily stay away from top 10. Once in a while, we'll do a number 8 or a number 9 or something along those lines. We opted to stay away from the highest levels of implied volatility, even though, granted, they do offer the highest levels typically. I say typically, not always, but typically the highest levels of reward on risk. We decide to kind of shade away from the highest ones in order to possibly have a higher probability of success with regards to our overall basket of trades, all right? So I'm going to come over here. I've got it sorted by implied volatility. I'm going to come down here. I'm going to go 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. So we can start off here with Oracle. I'm going to come over here. Let's go ahead and bring up Oracle. One thing I noticed here with Oracle was we have earnings right there. So we're probably going to pass on Oracle because we have earnings just in a day or two. This would involve a different strategy altogether. There is a strategy that you can use with regards to short verticals, but we're not going to be looking at that strategy here today. And just to remind investors of that, that does remind me when we talk about strategies in the past, we put on a trade last week. We also have an existing trade, and we will touch bases on those trades towards the end of our session here today as well. Okay, so let's come over here and take a look at Uber. So here's Uber right here. Looks like Uber, nice strong move here, pull back on a bounce. Let's look a little bit further though. Maybe we can find something that's a little bit more in a sideways channel. We could go ahead and put together some numbers on Uber. In looking at our numbers, though, let me just call your attention to our metrics here in relationship to our short verticals. Let me bring our little scratch pad up here. These are the metrics that we'll typically use. Again, we're playing the part of the investor that likes to use these metrics. This isn't necessarily the best metrics, okay? But these are the metrics we're using here. We want a probability of success of at least 70% or higher, okay? We want a return on risk of 1% for each day that we're in the trade, and we'll run the numbers on a possible candidate here. We'd like a minimum credit of 21 cents for each dollar wide. So if we're doing a $1 wide spread, we want a credit of at least 21. If we're doing a $2 wide spread, we want a credit of at least 42 cents, okay, or $42. We also want to have a technical justification for the trade. So those are four primary metrics that we use in here. Probability of success, 70% or higher, return on risk, 1% for each day, minimum credit, 21 cents for each dollar wide, and a technical justification for the trade. Okay, so speaking about technical justification, then let's come on down here and see what we got here. So we're going to try to find something that's a little bit more in a sideways range. We'll come down here. We looked at Uber, Schulenberger. Oof, boy, look at that thing. It's kind of fallen out here. So this would be a stock that's in a sideways range right here, but it's broken out of support, possibly a candidate for a short call vertical up in this area. We may come back to that because that's a sideways range breakout. Intel, we currently have a position on Intel. We'll review that at the end of our session here today. Taiwan Semiconductor pulling down here and getting a bounce. Nike is off and running here. So nice little breakout here, Nike, strong run up here in the overbought area right here. Doesn't mean it can't continue to go, but it is interesting to look at our candlestick pattern here. We have here investors is what's called an advanced block from a technical analysis standpoint. When you look at a candlestick pattern following a breakout here, notice that the height of these candlesticks are getting smaller and smaller. We have this big one. I'm going to zoom in here just a little bit. See if we can see this a little bit better. There we go right there. So there's our breakout. Notice the height of this candlestick. The next one, smaller, the next one, smaller, the next one, it could even be smaller. This is referred to it as a advanced block and does suggest a reversal and a move to the downside, particularly when this overbought area. Do we know that's going to occur? We don't, but we do want to keep in mind those candlestick patterns because they can be helpful with regards to our analysis. Come down here, taking a look at Meta, pull back. This looks more a little bit more like a falling knife trade. We've talked about those. Like to find something a little bit more sideways. Boy, look, this is kind of an example of the financial area right here. That's some of those banks moving up strong. That's a possibility here. Look at that. We got a sideways pattern right there, but we're not in the overbought area. Come down here. That's more of a breakdown moving down there. Amazon. Looks like Amazon is coming. So Amazon's up here in the higher level. We didn't quite get to the overbought area, but we are sliding down here. We do have a nice sideways channel up here. So let's take a look at Amazon. I'm going to go ahead and identify this. We'll come down here and get a different tool here. We'll come off of our channel tool and use our price tool. I'll be looking at that support for Amazon and that is resistance for Amazon. I'm going to decrease our time frame here just a little bit. Let's go to the last 6 months, maybe. All right, so here we have Amazon. You know, Amazon, the RSI, we don't have what could be considered by some to be like a perfect RSI situation where we've gone up and we're in the upper reversal zone and we're breaking down. We did see that on the S&P 500. We continue to go through stocks here, but we don't want to run out of time here, okay? Now, grand investors, I got a lot more stocks I can look through here, and this kind of underlines something important is that we're in here to teach you a process, okay? We're not in here to find you the best stocks, okay? So Amazon is likely not the best stock. You have a lot of other choices to go in here. We've talked about different things you may be looking for in relationship to current market conditions. Amazon, yeah, it's kind of up there. The RSI went up towards upper reversal, didn't quite make it, but now it's sliding down. But I think we'll go ahead and use this as our example stock here, okay? So we've got things moving up here. And what we'll do is, investors, we'll play the part of the investor, okay, that's looking at the market overall and maybe is leaning a little bit more to the bearish side rather than the bullish side, because on this particular stock anyway, we have the RSI moving to the downside up here, and the RSI is sliding up here to the downside. Today, we're moving down here. We've had difficulty with that resistance level, difficulty with the support level. We could wait for a breakout, but we'll go ahead and be a little bit more aggressive and enter now. The advantage of entering now rather than waiting for a breakout, we're probably going to be able to get higher above this resistance level than if we waited for a breakout down below the support level right here. Now, the problem with that, though, is what if we don't break down below here? What if we break out here? Then we'll have a trade that will be in some trouble. Now, another reason I'm going to look at a short call vertical here is because we have two existing short put verticals. Frankly, both of them are in trouble. We will take a look at that. Let's go ahead and mix things up a little bit. Play the part of the investor that's saying, okay, I got a couple of short puts. Maybe I want to put on a short call because of what's gone on in the market here a little bit, possibly bounce things out somewhat. Okay. All right. So we've got our resistance level here. I just want to identify that. And to do that, I'm going to do a right click right here. I'm going to choose edit properties. And let's show that over there on the left-hand side. There we have it at 148.42. So we want to sell a short call vertical above the 148.42. Okay, folks, I'm going to pause here for just a second. Come over here and take a look at the chat window. All right, just see where I have advantage of the platform here. Perhaps I can help out maybe help out with a question or two that's difficult for Mike because he doesn't have the platform. Looks like Mike's taking good care of you here. Questions on that stuff. So again, a big thanks to Mike. It looks like you guys are in good shape. I'm not seeing anything that really jumps out to me. Okay, so great. Let's go ahead and take a look then and see what we've got going on here, though. To do that, I'm going to come up here to the trade tab for Amazon. I'm going to go ahead and collapse our left-hand side over here. Trade Amazon, and typically in here, we've gone out about 20 to 30 days. So in this area right here, we'll go ahead and take a look at the 23 right here. Let's take a look at this guy. Take a look at that guy off of there. Come over here. Here's 23. We'll come over here. Remember, investors, we wanted to have a theoretical probability of success of 70% or greater. So that means if we use the delta column, and the delta column can be used, by the way, there's other tools on the Thinkorswim platform that you can use. I like to keep a lot of real estate here available, so I'm okay just using the delta. But on the delta here, if the delta is giving us the theoretical probability that this strike price will be in the money on the expiration date. So if the strike price is in the money on the expiration date, that means that the trade is not successful. If the strike price is out of the money on the expiration date, that means the trade is more likely to be successful. So if you think about it, we want our delta to be at 30 or lower, because of the 30 delta, it's a 30% probability that our trade will not be successful, which means there's a 70% theoretical probability that our trade will be successful. We do want to keep in mind these are theoretical probabilities, and we'll take a look at a couple of short put verticals where we follow these rules and they're in trouble right now. Okay, so you do want to keep in mind that these are theoretical situations. Okay, so over here, if I went with a 150, let me just bring this down so we can see this a little bit better. Okay, if I went with the 150, 152. Short call vertical, the 150 has a delta of 34, which means our probability of success would be 66 rather than 70. If I come down here to the, if I do a 152.50, 155, these are going to be $2.50 wide now. If I do a 152, 155, then our theoretical probability of success is going to be 75% because our delta is sitting at 25. So let's take a look at this, see how it fits in with regards to some of the other parameters that we'll be looking at here. So I'm going to do a right click right here and choose sell, and we'll go vertical. It looks like I have an opportunity to catch a credit of 45.46. One of the things that's nice about Amazon is look at the difference between the mid and the natural price. There's only a 2 cent difference. This tells us that these options are very liquid when you're looking at the slippage between the bid and the ask. We can see right here, it's a penny here and a penny here. So that is one of the nice things about potentially trading Amazon right here is the slippage right there. Let's say we're able to catch a credit of 45 here. I'm going to bring up a little calculator here so we can calculate our reward to risk. So we are at $2.50 wide, 152, 155. We're looking for a credit of 45. So our maximum loss here, our theoretical maximum loss will be the difference between the strike prices minus our credit, which is our theoretical maximum gain. So 250 minus 45 gives us a theoretical maximum loss of 205. Now, again, this does not include transaction fees and the like. So we want to remember that. But a theoretical maximum loss of 205. So in calculating our reward risk, then we can take 45, our maximum gain, divided by our theoretical maximum loss of 205. And we're looking at a return here of 21.9, so about 22% over 23 days. So we're 1% shy of where we would like to be. Do we want to go ahead and stretch the limit a little bit? Well, in the interest of time, yes. Okay. In the interest of time, we'll go ahead and say yes here. Our return on risk is 1% shy where we'd like to be. We'd like to be at 23% here. However, our theoretical probability of success is at 76 now, because this just dropped down to 24. Is it 76 rather than 70, 71, 72, or 73? So we're going to go ahead and look at that play up. We're going for a little bit higher reward on risk at about 75, 76, a little bit lower on the return, which is sitting here at about 22 rather than 23, which is what we'd ideally like to have. Okay. Now our credit here, if we're sitting at a credit here of 45, how does that relate to being $2.50 wide? We said we wanted to get 21 here, right? 21 for each dollar wide. I'm going to times that by 2.5, and we'd like to get 52. So the ideal situation here with regards to our credit investors is 52.5. But you know what? I think I'm going to work a little bit with regards to that particular metric, because I just know the wider you get here, the lower the credit is in relationship to the width. So what I'm kind of leaning towards doing is saying that we want to get the 21 if we're a dollar wide, but if we're wider than a dollar wide, then we're going to default and look more along these at from the standpoint of return on risk for each day that we are in the trade. Okay, in fact, let's go ahead and do that now, just so we have that. I put these up kind of as we're getting our session. I'm just saying minimum credit of 21 for. I'm going to change this. For dollar wide spreads, because I don't think it's practical to say for each dollar wide. Okay, so we made a little bit of adjustment there, and we'll use that going forward. All right, investors. So I'm going to take our padlock off here. It looks like now we're looking at maybe getting 46 or 47. So that is interesting, but this is still sitting here at 34. So let's go ahead and stay with that. How many of these do we want to do then? Well, let's look at our position sizing again here. So we're going to go ahead and use 205, and let's say, you know, the market is kind of jittery right now. It doesn't, you know, it's kind of hard to know, is it going to go up or is it going to go down? So let's play the part of the investor who doesn't have the level of confidence they usually have, where they might usually risk 1,000. Let's say this investor's okay, I'm given market conditions, risking 500. We'll take 500 divided by 205. Whoops, let's try that again. 500 divided by 205. Looks like we can do 2.43 of these. Let's just do two of these. We'll go two of them right here. And it looks like we are ready to rumble. Let's see if we can go ahead and catch this 46 and do a confirm and send right here. It's always important to read your information here. This is going to give us our maximum loss theoretically is 408. That's a theoretical max loss. Our maximum profit theoretically is 92. That's going to be two times this guy right here. And our resulting buying power effect and those types of things, we're good with that. Let's go ahead and send our order in. There it goes. And we got it. Okay, so that one is filled. Now, investors, let's take a breath here. Whew. Let's come over here and take a look at our existing position. So here's our new Amazon position right here. We'll see how that turns out. We're sitting out here 23 days. Here is a position. It looks like this is the one we put on last week on Intel. Notice we're currently showing a loss here. Looks like we had a little bit of improvement today, but currently showing a loss. There's a couple of key aspects to look at these. And let me just grab our little tool here so that we can identify these things. as we're looking at stuff here, let's maybe a little pointer tool would be nice. Let's use this right here. Okay, so notice on our Intel trade, okay, our Intel trade is showing a loss here. Okay. Where's the stock? Where's the price of stock currently at? It's 41.94, so it's almost 42. What's our short strike price? Our short strike price is 43. Our long strike price is 42. So currently we are outside of the spread. You just want to remember, if things stay like this, we're going to incur a maximum loss. However, we are only a dollar wide, and a key aspect of this is how many days do we have left? We have 23 days. We basically have a little bit more than 3 weeks left. So a lot can happen on this one. I'm going to go ahead and play the part of the investor that's okay leaving this where it's at. We'll go ahead and take a look at the chart following our little diagram here, but I'm going to play the part of the investor that's okay leaving this currently where it is at. Okay. Now looking at NVO, this trade's also in trouble. We can see we currently have a loss right here. On this one, we only have 9 days till expiration. Our short strike price is at 99. This is also a dollar wide. Our long strike price is at 98. So we want to be above 99. Where are we at right now? Well, we are at 98.24. So there is a couple things to keep in mind here. One is possibly a roll. That would possibly, we can take a look at the chart and say, okay, do we feel like we need more time to recover? If so, then we can look to see if we can do a roll. However, if we do a roll, we'd like to do that roll for some kind of a credit. It doesn't need to be a big credit, but we don't want to do a roll at a debit typically in these types of situations. It might be better just to go ahead and cut our losses now or go ahead and let this thing play out. Do keep in mind that on both of these trades, when we set up our position size, on one of these we have 6, on the other one we have 12. When we set our position size, we set our position size from the standpoint that was a position size when looking at the maximum loss. We were okay with that. We're looking at the max loss saying, hey, I'm okay with the max loss. I'm not going to lose any sleep on it. So from that standpoint, that's a healthy place to be because we're okay letting the probabilities play out. Just do keep in mind, when we're talking about these probabilities of success, they involve staying in the trade for the entire time. So anytime we exit these trades early, then we're not letting those probabilities play out. There have been times where we've gone into a trade, gone ahead and gotten out of the trade or made adjustment to a trade just to see the trade recover. We would not have had to do anything. However, there's nothing wrong with going in and managing these things as well. Okay. All right. But this is sort of the scenario that we're currently looking at. Let's take a look at the charts here for both of these. And I'm going to take this guy off of here, like so, and let's run this fellow off here. Well, let's start off here with NVO because this one looks like the one that's the most perilous, okay? 9 days to get above $99. Is that a realistic expectation? Went into the chart and NVO. Oh, okay, ouch, all right. So notice that it's coming down. So one of the nice things is in the past, it has found support at the 50 period moving average. We don't know it's going to find support here, but you know, it came down here one day below, then up here, came here, hit it up here. We're going to come down here, hit it and find support here. It's a possibility. How high does it have to go in order for us to be in a good place? Well, it has to get up here to 99. So it's not too far away. If you look at that and you know, the reality is if we roll over that candle right there, the high today was at 99.26. So it's not currently a situation where it's blown so far away that we're, oh, you know what, I don't know what to do, right? There is a reasonable possibility that if we got a bounce here, for example, tomorrow, if we kind of stayed here and then got a bounce, or possibly we get a run going into the closer today, this position could easily correct itself, taking into consideration the range that it's been trading, particularly if we give it 9 days. So one of the possibilities here is just to let the probabilities play out. Now there is another possibility here as well. And let me show you that. Let me just check to see how we're doing on time. Looks like we're doing okay on time. The other possibility of this, investors, is to change this or convert it to an iron butterfly. The nice thing about doing an iron butterfly, if you want to approach this, if you do an iron butterfly, you decrease your risk, okay, with regards to management here. This is a management process that decreases the risk, still offers you an opportunity for success, but your probability of success is extremely diminished following doing that, okay? So if we want to do an iron butterfly, let's come over here to the analyze page here and look at NVO here. So here is our short of the analyze page here and look at NVO here. So here is our short vertical. This is where the price is currently at. You see, we just need to move up here about a buck and we're going to be in good shape. But what if we said, okay, maybe I want to do something to alleviate some of the risk that's going on right here. And you can see that here's zero right here. This is the risk coming all the way down here. So we currently have on this trade $900 of risk. Was there a way to eliminate some of that risk, still be in the trade and give us an opportunity for success? There is. And let's just show an example of that. We'll be converting this to an iron butterfly. And what you do is I'm going to come up here and choose add simulated trades right here. And NVO, we want to identify our short strike price on this. Our short strike price is 99. Now, the ideal time to do this, investors, is not when we're sitting here at 98. It's when we're sitting right at 99. So if you're considering this particular strategy with regards to managing your trade, which decreases your risk, severely limits your probability of success, but does decrease your risk, keep in mind the sweet spot for this is when you're sitting right at 99. In fact, earlier today when we opened, we were sitting right at 99. So that would have been the opportune time. Let's still see what it looks like now, okay? So I've got 99 right here. I'm going to come over here and do a right click right here. Notice what I'm doing. All I'm doing is I'm doing a short call vertical. So an iron butterfly is simply a short put vertical and a short call vertical that share the same short strike price. Do right click right here. I'm going to choose analyze sell trade. I'm going to add that on there, okay? So now we have a short call vertical. Now notice my credit right here is 35. What if we would have done this when the 99 was the at the money? Okay, right now the 98 is the at the money because that's where we're sitting. In other words, what if we would have done this when the market first opened? Well, I'm going to go ahead and turn this thing off right here for a second. And let's come up here to the 98. Now, this will not be an iron butterfly. What I want to illustrate here is the difference in credits. If I come over here and I use the at the money, do a short call vertical right here. In fact, let me get rid of this one for just a second. I'm going to delete that one. Coming right over here, if we would have right here, and whoops, I don't want that one either. I want to do a short call vertical at the money. We would have gotten a credit here of 50 cents, so a significantly larger credit. Okay, so I just wanted to highlight that, the benefit of doing it at the money, but we don't have that choice right now. So let me do this and say, okay, we don't have that choice. Maybe we can wait until the market goes into the close. But let's see what we'd be looking at right now if we did this one. Go over here and do a vertical right here. So now we're looking at 35. What does this do to our risk? Remember, we were risking like $980. If we do this, what does our risk profile look like? Well, now, oops, we need to get the same number of contracts. So we got 12 here. Let's go 12 on this one. Match everything up. Okay, so there's 12. Okay, so now instead of risking $900, we basically cut that in half or very close to half. Now we're risking $456. Now we have this relatively narrow area of success. You know, if we, you know, over the next 9 days, if we come somewhere in here, then we're probably going to be in, then we have the possibility of being in good shape. If we go too far up here, though, then we're backing down here and running into our loss right here. Okay, so just I did want to show you this as a potential strategy to help in relationship to this. But since we're so close, we're sitting here at 98, I'm going to go ahead and play the part of the investor here. It's okay. Well, let me come off of that a little bit, okay? We do have enough time here to run a quick poll, okay? So let me throw it out to all of you, okay? Do you want to convert this to an iron butterfly? Decrease our risk here, give us still an opportunity for profitability in here for the next 9 trading days, all right? Or do you want to let the probabilities play out? We're looking at a situation like here where we can recover here, doesn't matter how high we go, but now we're sitting a risk here of $900 versus risk here of $456. I'm going to leave it up to you guys. So over there in the chat window, just chat in, leave it or convert it, okay? Chat in, leave it or convert it into the chat window, okay? Leave it, give us the 9 days, it's totally a possibility there, or convert it, decrease our risk there. So leave it or convert it, investors, all right? Okay, so we've got that. So now that we're looking at our old trades, perhaps it's a good time to review our overall performance as we've been doing these. Just a reminder, I like to bring this up on a weekly basis, just as a reminder, folks. We've been doing these trades since July of 2020, and we have completed 184 trades. On those 184 trades, we've been successful on 82.6 of those trades. We've been unsuccessful on 17.4% of those trades. Our average return on risk has been 17.6%, and our average days in the trade has been 13.4. Do keep in mind that over that entire time, we have used a paper money virtual trading account, which tends to be more forgiving than an actual live trading situation. So you wouldn't want to necessarily expect that to occur in your actual live trading account. Also, do keep in mind that it's important to find your own individual stocks. We basically teach the process, and then we encourage you to use the process to find possibly stocks that are going to be better suited for that process, because we're somewhat limited with regards to time here. Okay, all right. So we've got that. I'm going to come over here and check. Well, you guys are totally into convert. Okay, let's go ahead and convert it then. All right, I'm surprised. All right. But I'm okay with that. Let's go ahead and convert this. So I'm going to do a right click right here. I'm going to choose create duplicate order. Here we are here. Hopefully, let's see if we can catch our 37 here. I'm going to do a confirm send. We don't have the same liquidity here on NBO that we had on Amazon. Let's first of all see if we can get 37 here. We'll do a confirm short vertical send. There it goes. Now again, this is a paper money account investor, so it does tend to be more forgiving. You may not have that ease of conversion in an actual situation, okay? We got it all set up, and let's see here. What is going on here, Jack? This does not look correct to me. There's our short call, vertical. All right, folks, so let's see. We've got 99 here, I need to take this one off. That's what's going on. Let's see. And you know, I feel like we're in good shape here. This is just having a hard time resetting here. Let's do this. Instead of show all, let's just say hide simulations. There we are. There we are right there. Okay, so there we are. All right, investors, let's go ahead and wrap things up here for today. All righty. Let's see how we did here with regards to our discussion here. So what do we want to do? Well, we wanted to discuss trade management. That's part of what we wanted to do. We wanted to discuss techniques, particularly in relationship to our sentiment. You know, are we bullish, are we bearish, are we somewhat neutral? We decided to kind of balance off with regards to our put inventory with a short call vertical, looking at Amazon. So I believe we did accomplish primarily what we wanted to accomplish here today. Just remind investors, you can follow me on Amazon. Excuse me. You can follow me on X, all right? My handle on X is at KenRoseCS. I also encourage you to follow Mike on X. He posts a lot of great information over there. Also, circle your calendars, okay? I believe it's Monday, if I'm not mistaken. Mike teaches an excellent generating income in your portfolio. I'm not sure. I think it's Monday, but Mike, if I'm wrong, if you can correct me over there in the chat, I'm sure everybody would appreciate that, so they can highlight that symbol, that session going forward here. All right, everybody. Well, hey, hope you have a great afternoon and a fantastic evening and wonderful rest of your week. Best of success in your investing, and hope to see you back here again next time. Bye, everybody. We'll catch you later, and thanks again.